Hello and welcome to the newspapers with me, Frank LeDuc, and my guest, Dominic Ponsford, the editor of Press Gazette, which is, I suppose, the sort of the trade mag for our rough trade, really, for
The Bible.
The Bible, but the Bible for journalists.
Yeah, the actual Bible. That's what we are.
And you're online only these days?
Yes.
As someone who's online only at Brighton and Hove News, I have every admiration for people who take this brave and bold step. Much as I still love ink and paper and everything.
It's where the action is.
It's where the future is, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
But I have to say, I still love having a newspaper in my hands. You've had quite a few in your hands this week. What's been dominating the headlines?
Yeah, well, big story, amazingly, 27 years on, is Hillsborough, as we know. Anyone who's sort of seen a news bulletin or picked up a newspaper will have seen that we finally got the inquest verdict, which came about, actually, partly as a result of a newspaper campaign, which was the great Liverpool Echo, Justice for the 96. They've been banging on about this while everyone else had forgotten about it, apart from the people on Merseyside. And so we've got some great coverage from them. And it's been an interesting story, an interesting contrast between the way they've covered it and the way the Nationals have covered it. Because again, the Nationals, some of the Nationals not covering themselves in glory this week.
Well, there's at least one national newspaper I can think of that doesn't really sell on Merseyside anymore. And that's The Sun.
So amazingly, isn't it? So 27 years on, The Sun back in 1989 wrote this, had this infamous front page, The Truth, where they reported what we now know to be lies from police sources and from a local MP and from the local
ambulance chief,
I think, as well. So multiple sources, but they were taken in, and they said that, you know, that the fans were basically responsible for the disasters, and they did terrible things, you know, while it was unfolding. And so The Sun, I mean, various papers covered that at the time, but The Sun went much further and were much more forthright, and they actually said, you know, this is the truth. They didn't couch it in the way as a journalist you should, saying these are reports, this is one side, but this is another side. They had one side of it, and obviously their sales collapsed on Merseyside. They never recovered. So this week they didn't cover the Hillsborough verdict on the front page. They're only one of two or three papers that didn't cover it on the front page. So they were kind of vilified again, but I guess probably what could they have done now? You know, whatever they do, they stick it on the front page, they'll probably still get, you know, vilified.
But so they might think, well, you know, we're not going to recover our sale in Merseyside, there's no point. But actually, you know, I think a lot of readers have a sense of natural justice, and they and feel that, you know, I mean, The Sun did do a front page 3-4 years ago, The Real Truth, when it became accepted that actually the fans' version of events was more reliable than the ones reported under the headline The Truth, and in other, as we said, in other papers at the time. Why was The Sun and Kelvin McKenzie in particular vilified so much over that headline, do you think, back in 89?
Well, I think they were rather taken in by the kind of the view that the fans were all hooligans, and it was really the fact they just didn't couch it. They just said, you know, these are facts, and he just pushed it too far, too much topspin, which is always a danger as a journalist.
I mean, they're quite a strong projection, isn't it? And also, I think that Merseyside is broadly left of centre. The Sun at that stage was very much a right of centre paper.
Yeah. We got the front pages from the Echo. I thought they were worth seeing. Those great. There we go. So this was the late edition they brought out on the day of the verdict, which was, I think, God, quick moving from them, quick footwork, and name the song.
Well, I'm guessing that's from You'll Never Walk Alone.
Yeah,
I should. I'd like to tell you I know, but I'm guessing that's definitely from.
Yeah. You got it. From the film, from the Rodgers and Hammerstein musical.
Well, that goes back a long time. Is it Carousel?
Carousel, yeah, that's it. Yeah. And this was their front page they did the following day. So, you know, God, wonderful, like you say, talking about projection. Yeah. There's some projection there, haven't they?
Very good.
And, the editor there, we are speaking to him actually this week, and he was sort of saying, you know, well, what were you thinking about? And he was saying it was nothing to do with sales or anything like that. It was just about recording this moment for the people of Liverpool, which I think is quite a nice way.
Isn't it funny, because we've lost this idea of newspapers as, you know, the newspaper of record? The idea, you know, the conversation about whether a newspaper should be a newspaper of record seems to have, that moment seems long to have passed.
You know, just an aside on the Liverpool Echo, they were the only paper that had a journalist every day of that inquest for two years. So one reporter whose job was just to, and she blogged every line of evidence, so everything that happened, she wrote. And it was quite interesting. They did some interviews with some of the families this week.
Yes.
And they were sort of saying how much that meant to them, because not everyone could go to the inquest every day. I'm sure very few of them could, but they could keep in touch with it. So it actually meant a huge amount to them. And then she did reports and so on. And they've done an absolutely great job on this, the Echo.
I mean, I'm sure you've had that experience of going to court as a reporter and sometimes feeling it's a little bit of a sort of lawyer's club, as it were. And I think sometimes those taking part in the process professionally forget that, you know, we don't go there for fun. Yeah. We're there because the public doesn't always have the time or the inclination to go, but actually justice should be not just done, but seen to be done.
Oh, exactly, and, very much so, yeah.
We're the sort of, if you like, the channel by which it is seen to be done in many cases.
Exactly, yeah.
What have you got next, Dom?
So we're just going to dive into some of that evidence. I mean, the Echo pulled out some of this, but this was the one of the dramatic points from the from the inquest, which was when Kenny Dalglish gave evidence. And he basically said it was the day the Hillsborough match commander's barrister took on Kenny Dalglish and lost. And it was one of these things where, I mean, if you've ever been into court, like you were saying, you know, the barristers are very combative. And it's all, you know, it's really surprising to watch, actually, if you're not used to that. And so John Beggs QC, who was representing the match commanders, the police officers, David Duckenfield and others, really sort of tore into Kenny Dalglish and started pulling out some stuff from Kenny Dalglish's autobiography. And he says, you an icon, I'm going to suggest a very important role model to young men. And Dalglish started laughing, and he said, and then Dalglish says, he said, I don't think you've read that properly. He said, you know, I'm not an icon, you're calling me an icon. And then in the end, he basically says, I didn't actually write the book anyway, his autobiography.
A ghostwriter
wrote it. But, you know, he's actually what comes across in the report is Dalglish, as he's been throughout this over the decades, you know, extremely dignified, extremely self-possessed, and, you know, the QC looks just like a bit of a wally, really, and just like, you know, and, you know, is an inquest into the deaths of 96 people the place to have that kind of, like, you know, kind of combative role?
That's astonishing, isn't it? I mean, I think a lot of people think that, you know, footballers are not always necessarily terribly bright, but actually, I guess, like any other section of society, you've got some who are. Perhaps not the full Monty, and others who are actually quite sharp. And although Dalglish can be very difficult to understand with his thick accent sometimes, I imagine he's quite a shrewd guy.
Yeah, he certainly comes across as that. And then one more piece from the Echo, which was their response to Sun editor Kelvin McKenzie. So on the day that inquest came out, the Sun didn't actually say anything, but the editor at the time, Kelvin McKenzie, issued a statement basically saying, you know, I was completely duped. Story came from an agency, senior police officers, head of the ambulance service, Tory MP. They all said it was the fans. It's clear today the fans had nothing to do with it. So the Echo really making the point that, you know, Kelvin, we don't want to hear your excuses today, thanks very much. You know, he still hasn't really learned his lesson, has he? I mean, you know, it's not about you, Kelvin, it's about, you know, the tragedy. So, I mean, it's sort of worth being in there, because the Liverpool Echo, such is the visceral hatred of the Sun on Merseyside, that they asterisk out the Sun whenever they mention him on the Liverpool Echo. So it just goes to show, really.
It's a very tongue-in-cheek way of getting back at the, yes. He's never going to be liked on Merseyside, is he?
No. I don't think he takes many holidays up there.
And what's next?
And then one final Hillsborough one, which is from the Herald in Plymouth, which is a really great piece actually from a journalist down there who is a Liverpool fan, and he recalls actually being involved in a crush back in 1977 when he was with tens of thousands of fans from Merseyside returning from a game in Manchester, and he describes how they were all funneled onto a platform of a train station, and he was involved in a very serious crush. And he said, and he recalls as they were being crushed, the police officers on the other side laughing at us and saying effing scousers, which just goes to show, you know, the seeds of this disaster were there for everyone to see a long time before, weren't they? And his final paragraph there is, you know, the real lesson from Hillsborough is that once you demonise a set of people, football fans, migrants, benefit scroungers, whoever, you put them at risk. You decide that their lives are not as valuable as your own, and when something goes wrong, you try to deny them justice. It was rather good, isn't it? In quite a good way. It's as good a piece as any I've read on this. Actually.
Very, very good. I mean, I saw the David Aronovich piece in the Times, which was making some very similar points, and it wasn't a sort of probably as cheerleading as someone might say the pieces of the Echo were. You know, he was probably taking a much more neutral stance and saying, you know, there were problems among fans in the 70s and 80s, but equally there was a problem with old stadiums that were worn out, and this was part of the disrespect shown towards fans, the fact that the stadiums weren't good, the fact that, you know, the policing was poor, and it was almost like a perfect storm coming together, which, you know, with the Bradford fire, the Hillsborough disaster, and again then at Hillsborough.
It was a dreadful period, wasn't it, for football? I mean, it's all my dim, a little bit younger than you, I think, but I remember it dimly. I remember the news, Bradford, Hillsborough, Hillsborough, it all sort of merged into one, didn't it?
Yes. Have you got a football team? Are you going to share this on air?
Brighton and Hove Albion, I should say.
We're recording this in Brighton, and it's not been a bad season for us. We have a brand new stadium, and it's very comfortable. I think a bit sardine-like getting there on the train, but otherwise a wonderful experience.
And I'm a born-again Leicester fan.
Well, and aren't we all? We'll talk about maybe after the break. We're going to take a quick break for the ads now, so please don't go away. Join us in just a few minutes. Thank you. Hello and welcome back to the newspapers with me, Frank LeDuc, and Dominic Ponsford from Press Gazette. Thanks for joining us, Dom. And let's leave Merseyside and wander into Wales. What's been happening there this week? They've got elections, haven't they?
Yeah. So there's quite a lot of local elections around, aren't there, next week, going to the polls on May 5th, is it?
May the 5th.
So, this is a good example of some good even-handed political coverage, I thought, from Wales Online. So you see, national press, very partisan, aren't they, in their political coverage?
Yes.
Even actually the Evening Standard, if you look in London, people say it's a little bit biased, actually, in favour of the Conservatives. Yeah. It's a really good even-handed report here of their leaders' debates. What they've done is they've actually given completely equal prominence to all the 6 party leaders who are on a TV hustings, and quite a good idea is they've got the readers to rate them, and then they give them the marks out of 10.
Interesting.
Which is, you can't argue with that, can you?
They've done it in alphabetical order, but the...
Alphabetical order, yeah, that's a good old tip from if you've covered local elections in regional papers, you have a formula, don't you? People will complain, won't they?
Oh, yes.
And so they've got Leanne Wood last, who's the Plaid Cymru? Cymru?
Yep.
I can't pronounce that.
Plaid Cymru, I think.
Yeah, that's where you get paid the big bucks. you can pronounce Plaid Cymru. But she gets 7.5 out of 10.
I'm prepared to be corrected on this, by the way.
Which is their top score.
Top score for she was on the leaders' debate in the general election, wasn't she, I think? But where Nicola Sturgeon came out tops.
Yeah, she came across quite well on that as well. So, interesting that they sort of, Wales and Scotland got female leaders. We haven't had a female leader in the Westminster for a long time, have we?
So, no.
But they were really good. They gave everyone a fair crack of the whip. Even Andrew Davis, the Welsh Conservative leader, who I wouldn't have thought was probably going to get many votes in Wales, especially what's going on over there with the steelworks and so on.
Yes. Well, let's move on to the other side of the country almost, really, Lincolnshire. They've got a lovely, magnificent cathedral in Lincoln. They've got problems, as a lot of old buildings have, and particularly old churches. What are they doing about it?
Yeah, so, you can't accuse Lincoln County Council of not having forward planning, because the beautiful cathedral there, we've got a picture of it, amazing, isn't it? Amazing,
lovely.
Unmistakable
lovely.
Norman cathedral there. It's been around for 1,000 years. Made out of local limestone. So they're concerned that the limestone is actually running out. So they need a certain amount of, they had to quarry a certain amount every year just to kind of repair the thing and keep it standing. So they've got a plan now to ensure that there's going to be enough limestone for the next 1,000 years. So they've identified a certain amount of local sites. There's only a limited number of sites where this limestone can be found. And they kind of put protection orders on them to make sure no one builds on them and to make sure that, that it's protected and that the beautiful cathedral and castle there are there as well. And they reckon, the main reason is it's a huge business for Lincoln, the beautiful architecture up there. And so it's a really good piece, this. And good good bit of background as well. The limestone was formed 165 million years ago in the warm tropical seas that covered Lincolnshire. The dinosaurs roamed the earth. So I love that. I love a bit of background detail. That's good.
I don't think anyone described the North Sea now as a warm tropical sea.
I know, those were the days, weren't they? But yeah, but apart from the dinosaurs, you know.
Maybe with global warming. Yeah. I mean, the we've all sort of had to, as reporters, you cover these things like strategic plans, and it's very hard to make them interesting for your readers, but they've really got to the nub of why, actually, with things like minerals plans, strategic plans, they matter.
Yeah.
And like you say, this is a huge part of the local economy, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
Can I drag you away from Lincoln onto another staple of local newspapers, one of my favourite topics, provided I'm not writing about it?
Dog mess. Yeah, we always have a dog mess story.
Fantastic.
Every week on the Region Roundup. You have to. So I don't know whether this is a piece of what we call data journalism.
Yep.
So what they've done is they've used the Freedom of Information Act, good old Freedom of Information Act, which is where so many good local newspaper stories come from, to find out the worst trouble spots in Manchester for dog messing, dog fouling, and they've mapped them. So I don't know if this is a bit of data journalism too far, I don't know. But I think it's quite interesting, isn't it? Very interesting, isn't it, if you're in Manchester. And the what's the worst one? The worst one is Dudley Road in Whalley Range, which apparently is quite a nice sort of leafy area.
Well, Withenshaw's got three spots in the top 10, and I think, yeah, mind how you walk in Withenshaw by the looks of it.
Yeah, exactly, it's good advice. And they've done it by mapping all the reports of dog fouling the Manchester Council's had over 12 months.
I'm intrigued.
More than 1,000.
I'm intrigued as to how they sort of gathered the data, if I can put it like that.
Yeah, so they keep the data, and it's got more than 1,000 reports. And I guess if someone's, you know, eggy enough about it to actually phone up the council, it's probably the tip of the iceberg, isn't it?
So. Listen, let's step away from the dog's mess, and let's talk about your purple sausage.
Yeah, this is...
We are recording this in Brighton, after all.
Purple sausages. Yeah, this is...
Why have we got purple sausages in the news?
Oh, yeah. Well, that's right. This is my story of the week. This is a great story. So there's a butcher down in the West Country. This is the Exeter Express and Echo. And he's obviously deeply affected by the death of pop icon Prince. And he's produced some purple sausages. So people for the ethical treatment of animals, PETA, have written to him, and they pointed out that Prince, as an outspoken vegan, is probably not the ideal way he'd want to be remembered by having purple sausages brought out in his name. But they suggested a solution for Paul Kenyon of Palace Premier Meats in Paignton. He said that maybe they could bring out some vegan sausages.
Are you taking the pee with all those peas?
I don't know. I have.
Vegan sausages.
Vegan sausages. So I don't know. It's a vegan. That sounds like a contradiction in terms to me. A vegan sausage.
Again, here in Brighton, and we've got a food festival this weekend. We've got loads of vegan, vegetarian. You know, I mean, we've got people who eat their own sandals and wear muesli here. You know.
I think it's a bit cruel to put vegans in sausages. But there's a really good report, this anyway, from the Express and Echo. And they've tracked down the point that the Prince even had a song called Animal Kingdom, which the lyrics go, "No member of the animal kingdom ever did a thing to me. It's why I don't eat red meat or white fish. Don't give me no blue cheese. We're all members of the animal kingdom. Leave your brothers and sisters in the sea." I don't think that's his best lyric, actually, do you? But that, there you go. So, purple sausages.
Purple sausages.
Purple sausages.
Bizarre. Let's all party like it. Anyway, I'm not kidding you, but we used to sing Let's All Party like it's 1999, and it seems such a long way in the future. And the thing is, and Let's All Meet Up in the Year 2000 as well by Pulp.
I know. So the year's gone.
Nostalgia now. And the nostalgia's not what it used to be. Where do we go from Devon?
Up to Nottingham. There's another staple of this programme, Have a Go Heroes.
I love
Have a Go Heroes. It's a Have a Go Hero and a hapless thief, which is always good fun. not for the
thick crook.
Yeah, exactly. Not for the criminal. But this is a court report. A good staple. Good staple of local journalism. This, and it's about a 41-year-old who'd been out on prison licence for another offence, and he was roped into being a lookout during a burglary. So he didn't let the fact that he had a metal tag, so,
one of his electronic tags.
Exactly, yeah, he's on probation or whatever. He didn't let that hold him back from, committing another crime, which I think is a no-no, actually, if you're on probation, isn't it? You know,
it
I think you're supposed
is.
To stay at home, let alone go out and do other burglaries. So the basically a neighbour heard this something going on, heard the breaking go up. He popped his head up and shouted at them, told them to clear off. So they legged it, and the as the court heard, very commendably, the neighbour set off after the man, who wasn't running very well because of his
presumably like his tag catching on his other leg.
Yeah, exactly. He was sort of limping off down the street. You
know. Who says electronic tags don't work?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So and anyway, the neighbour, who's not named, isn't tracked down. They haven't tracked him down, but he actually kind of physically restrained this guy until the police turned up. It's amazing, isn't it? Amazing that anyone would do that. You'd think you'd just sort of keep your head down, wouldn't you?
But he's not a criminal mastermind, obviously.
No. But anyway, he's been brought to justice. He hasn't been sentenced yet. But there you go.
Have a go, hero. Let's hear about somebody else who's been public spirited this week, again near our end of the country. This is over in Kent, isn't it?
Yeah, so another staple of local news, litter.
I thought you could say rubbish stories.
Yeah.
I love rubbish stories.
But this is over at Faversham in Kent, and it's a dad of three, Colin Shadbolt, 51. So I don't know if you remember that there was this big thing, clean it up for the Queen.
Yes.
So he's taken it.
Clean for the Queen.
He's taken it up. Taken this to heart, and he's actually gone round Salters Lane where he lives picking up litter. He's so cheesed off with it, he couldn't take it anymore. He's just got some bin bags and just cleared it up himself, which I think, oh, you know, so commendable. And I must say, I will pick up a piece of litter myself if I see it and on my street anyway,
yeah,
and put it in the bin. So he turns up at the council tip, you know, and you'd think they might sort of commend him for his his civic mindedness.
You're going to break my faith in.
I'm going to break your heart here, because the council tip said, oh, you know, sorry, we don't take litter that's picked up from the street. We only take domestic rubbish. So, you know, clear off. So he's actually sent away. So, I mean, goodness me. So anyway, Kent Online have gone to the Kent County Council, confronted them about this. You think they would sort of see the error of their ways. The absolutely humorless Kent County Council spokesman says, litter is a high priority in Kent, but we need to follow processes to ensure that waste is disposed of in the most appropriate way. So, I mean, goodness me, you know, so what's he going to do? So Colin's got to take...
We've got to leave it on a rubbish story, I'm afraid. I wanted to mention Leicester. You can never guess what they're writing about this week. It's football. Yeah. Thanks for joining us. Watch again soon.